through that. That was a waste of a good afternoon. About all we learned is there's always next year, right? I read that on a Cowboys post. So I guess it applies to us this year too. It hurts still, doesn't it? It hurts. It hurts. I guess we can all agree that together, that go Chiefs. Amen. I don't know very many people who like them Eagles. Ephesians chapter number 6, verse number 11 and 12. We're going to pull some things out of here tonight. We have been looking kind of behind the scenes in the Bible, kind of looking in the spiritual, celestial realm. And tonight we're going to try our best to bring it down out of the celestial into the terrestrial, bringing it down into our personal domain, if you will, and show how the effects of spiritual warfare goes on in our lives. And then we'll begin the process of reconstructing ourselves as warriors for Christ and warriors enabled by Christ. So we've got a long time to get there tonight. Tonight we're just going to take a look at just a couple of verses and then go back into Genesis and look at the battle that we spoke a little bit about last week closer. So let's look at verse number 11 and 12, if you don't mind standing for the reading of God's Word. It says this: "Put on the whole armor of God, that you may be able to stand against the wiles of the devil. For we wrestle not against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers, and the rulers of darkness of this world, against spiritual wickedness in high places." Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being so good to us. Lord, we ask you, God, that you would meet with us tonight. Help us to honor your word, be constructed by your word, reshaped, reformed into who you want us to be. Lord, I pray that you'd empty me of self and sin. Fill me with your spirit, because tonight it's the Super Bowl. And I pray that together, Lord Jesus, we leave no doubt, for it's in your name we pray. Amen. You may be seated. When I was growing up, I've told you many stories of many different aspects of myself. So you know that I was a kind of an ornery kid, and I liked sports, but I was also dumb. I don't know if I've ever really articulated that. I mean, I kind of exhibited that, right? I kind of illustrated that for you a few times. I was pretty much a dumb kid growing up, and if you're dumb, you make a lot of dumb decisions. I got invited to play football a few times with the older kids, and many times I got in trouble for that. But you never learn your lesson, right? One day I got invited to play with the older kids, and they were only a couple of years older than me, so it wasn't like it was a big step up. And they kept giving me the ball, and I was faster than them, so I just ran over them. Ran fast, ran, gone. Every chance I got, I took it to the house. This is where the dumb part comes in. I talked trash, and I was good at it. I said words that a preacher ought not say to other people, but I weren't a preacher yet, so it was okay, right? And I said things that I shouldn't have. And finally, I got this one kid mad at me. And I knew I made him mad, but I also knew he couldn't catch me. So they handed me the ball, and I made a move, and my cleat didn't cleat no more. And I slid one leg this way, one leg this way, and the next thing I know, he had hit me. And I thought we were playing football. But apparently, he was fighting. Because not only did he hit me, he continued to hit me. And I learned a lesson that day that sometimes you go looking for a fight, and sometimes the fight looks for you. Yeah, amen. And you're always going to be impacted by the fight. Because I'm going to be honest, every time I seen that kid and sit until I'm 39 years old, I get a little bit crazy about it. I'm twice his size now. And I look at him like, dude, not right in the head. Just give him a nod and walk on, man. Because you don't know what's about to happen. So, amen. So here we are. We are looking at one of the most impactful things that we need to understand is that we are wrestling. How many woke up this morning and recognizing that you were wrestling? None of us. No, you didn't know you were wrestling. You didn't get out of bed going, man, ready to fight today. You didn't get up and go, dun 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 dun. Did you get that? Nobody? You didn't wake up with the eye of the tiger, did you? No. Because you didn't really know, because you woke up expecting to go to work today. You thought everything was going to be exactly like it's supposed to be. You thought you were going to get in your car, go down the road, grab a Tudor's biscuit. Right, Mike? And everything was going to be hunky-dory, but you didn't know that you was fixing to find a fight. The fight has come looking for you. The Bible says this, that we are wrestling. Right? Every one of us, every day, we are in a war. And it says this, that we are wrestling not with flesh and blood. I'm pausing because I am you. And all I see is flesh and blood. I have people that I work with that I'd like to slap the taste out of their mouth. Anybody gonna get with me on that? Flesh and blood, I have learned over the years, is that which I wrestle with in my mind. But that is not the real issue. Paul wants to pull our minds past what we see and show you what operates behind the scene, what we are really fighting against at work, what we are really fighting against in the tutor's line, and what we are really fighting against all over our lives. It's principalities and powers and rulers in this dark world and against spiritual wickedness, not in low places, but in places that are higher than you. So here we are. We need to recognize, number one, that we are fighting a battle in the heavenlies. To understand this, we need to understand what the heavenlies are. There are three heavens. I paused there just to see if there's any people in here who's going to be like, yeah. Yeah. With absolutely no idea. Yeah. Yeah. Three heavens. So we got the first heaven, that is the atmosphere that surrounds the earth, the environment in which we live in. That's the first heaven. So where the earth stops, the heaven begins. Okay, then we have the second heaven, that is what we commonly refer to as outer space, where the stars and the planets exist. And then there is the third heaven. This is the throne of God. This is where the comings and goings of the angels, the control center of all the universe, this is where God sets up his kingdom, and he is telling everything to happen. Boom. Ephesians It gives us some insight on this third heaven a little bit. If you want to write this down and look with me, we're going to find some truths here starting in chapter 1, verse 3. Paul tells us that blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in what places? Heavenly places. So first and foremost, we need to know two things about that verse. First, God is in the heavenly places. Two, our spiritual blessings resides in heavenly places. Go on to verse 20, verse 22 of the same chapter. We see that which we have wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead and set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Far above principality. I put this in there just because I wanted to read it tonight. Far above the principalities and powers and might and dominion, every name that is named, not only in this world, but also in that which is to come, hath he put all things under his feet and given him to be the head over all things to the church. Christ is there. So we learned three things so far, right? God is there in heavenly places. Our blessings are in heavenly places. And Christ, seated at the right hand of the Father, is in heavenly places. Let's go on. Ephesians is fun now. Y'all go back and read this whole book. It'd take you about 16 seconds. Not me. It'd take me like 16 years. Go to chapter 2, verse 4. But God, who is rich in mercy, for his great love wherewith he loved us, even when we were dead in sins, hath he quickened us together with Christ. By grace are ye saved. And hath raised us up together, and made us sit together in heavenly places in Christ Jesus, that in the ages to come he might show the exceeding riches of his grace and his kindness towards us through Christ. What are you saying, preacher? Well, God's there. Christ's there. Our blessings are there. And we've got a reserved seat in Christ Jesus there. Amen? Let's go on. There's another one. I got one more. Chapter 3, verse 8. Some of this I'm just reading for fun, just to make the devil mad. Unto me, who am less than the least of all saints, is the grace given that I should preach among the Gentiles the unsearchable riches of Christ, and to make all men see what is the fellowship of the mystery, which from the beginning of the world hath been hid in God, who created all things by Jesus Christ. That's good stuff. To the intent that now unto the principalities and powers in heavenly places might be known by the church the manifold wisdom of God according to the eternal purpose which he purposeth in Christ Jesus our Lord, in whom we have boldness and access with confidence by faith of him. So now we see that angels operate in heavenly places. All of this. And there at the last it says we got access. Isn't that cool? All of this. I mean, there's just so much there, right? There's so much there that we need to understand that all of this stuff is going on in heavenly places. So it gets deep, right? It gets deep. So how do we bring it back to us? How do we bring that back to us? Well, it's kind of easy when we understand this, that the battle comes to us because of the relationship that we have. We have to recognize what happened. So we go back to about 3-4 weeks ago when we were talking about Lucifer. What was his job? He was to stand before God and reflect the glory back to God, but he got it confused, didn't he? He got it confused and he began to desire glory unto himself. So when he got the glory mixed up, he started, instead of working to show forth glory, he in shining back, he worked to gain glory. And now we find that we have a conflict that is taking place. And it is a spiritual battle, a battle that we may feel physically. It may look physical. We may experience it in a physical way, but it is fought and influenced in a spiritual, heavenly way. This is when Paul would say to us in verse number 11 that we have to put on the whole armor of God. Why? So that we may be able to, say it with me, stand. Let's do it again. Stand. One more time for the ones in the back. Stand. So why are we putting on the full armor? So that we can stand. What are we standing against, preacher? What are, go ahead now, y'all's all with me now. What are we standing with? Against our, the wiles of the devil. So we are standing with the full armor on for the purpose of standing against the wiles of the devil. We're going to come back to the armor, not tonight, another night, but we're going to look a little bit closer tonight at the wiles of the devil. What is wiles, preacher? It means this: his schemes or devices, his mechanism of warfare. You said, preacher, you taught about that last Wednesday night. You did. I did. No. This is a little bit deeper. That was all surface. We're going to dig in a little closer. We're going to hit it from a different direction. We're going to go back to Genesis chapter number 2. And 3. You ready? Say, preacher, I don't know where that is. Go to the front of the book. Go 2 chapters in and wait. Okay. We're going to take a look at this, and we're going to learn, and we're going to see some things in Genesis that needs extracted so that we can understand a little bit closer at the battle we're facing. Because the battle that we're facing is not as hard to fight as we think. I'm gonna tell the end of the story, and then we'll work back towards it, okay? It all stems from obedience. Okay? Say it with me. Obedience. Thank you. So it all starts with obedience. Look, we need to see first and foremost the mention of God's direction, verse 9 of chapter 2. And then we'll look at verse 16 and 17, so be with me right there. So we see this, that God has created the heavens and the earth. He made cows to moo, right? He made all the animals. He made the fish of the sea. He made the fowls of the air. He made all of this. He separated darkness and light. I know these are not in order, but these are all things that he did. And then he created God, or he created man in his image, in his likeness. He made us. That's amazing, right? don't play that down. That's pretty cool. And then he takes man and he sets him in the middle of the garden. That's awesome. These are all really cool things that we learn in Sunday school. And then as we grow up, we take for granted. We're like, yeah, in the garden. So he takes man at his most perfect state, puts him in the place, in the perfect will of God, in the location of his perfect will. All of this, you get what I'm saying? There could not be a more perfect point in history than Adam and Eve in the Garden of Eden. And the Bible says this in verse number 29, or verse number 9, I'm sorry. He says this, and out of the ground made the Lord to grow every tree that is pleasant to the sight. and good for food. The tree of life also was in the midst of the garden, and the tree of good of the knowledge of good and evil. So he put these planted. Boom. Everything. And it all looked good. We need to understand this. That there was not one thing that looked better than the other. Say it again. There was not one fruit that looked more delicious than the other. Don't let Satan and social media, don't let the television manipulate your mind to make you think that it was just this spectacular sight to see this thing hanging there. No. Everything in the garden was good. Look at verse 16. God comes and he says to the man, he lays down some groundwork. Lord commanded man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou mayest eat freely. You can eat it freely. But of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat it. For in the day that thou eatest thereof thou shalt surely die. These are simple directions mentioned by God, right? The responsibility to mankind now is, will you show obedience to God? Nothing complex, right? God did not say there is an order to which you eat. You can eat this tree, this tree, this tree, this tree, this tree, this tree. This is Monday, this is Tuesday, this is Wednesday. No. He said you can eat them all freely. But here we have the simple concept of you can eat all these trees except for this one. This is it. And when you do, you're going to die. So, man has the option, obedience or death. Wow. Man, is this not simple stuff right now? It's like to your kid. If you touch that, you will get burnt. Then they go, right? It's like the first thing they do. Listen to me. It doesn't matter what you do. You can tell them all you want to. Ah, that's hot. I just told you it was hot. God said, don't touch that, you'll die. He says, don't eat it, or you'll die. I'm getting ahead of myself. I'm starting to talk like Eve. See, not only will we find the mention of God's direction, but we also see the method of Satan's attack. Look at verse number 3. We go on in time. There's some time exists. Some creation happens. A rib gets taken. Eve is now present, and we have Adam and Eve in the garden together now. And I love this. Look at verse number 1. Now the serpent was more subtle than any beast of the field which the Lord God had made. Well, now there's a difference, right? All of the trees, there was no difference except for the fact that you couldn't have this one. And this one was for life. This is the only difference. But now we've got Satan who chooses to be the most subtle. The one that was looks a little more tender, pleasant to the eyes, not scary, not offensive. I've got all kinds of things I'm editing out because I could go on a rampage right now of subtlety. And he said to the woman, hath God said, you shall not eat of every tree of the garden? Look, he doesn't say hi. Did y'all notice that? This is the first recorded conversation. There's no like, hey, girl, what's up? Like, you know what I mean? There's no like, you get what I'm saying here? There's no like, hey, you know, hey, what you gonna do later? Like, you wanna go get a soda pop or something? There's no lead up. He just walks up to her, and the first conversation he wants to have is not about Eve. The subject is relational. Her relationship with God. His focus is on God. You say, why, preacher, would Satan focus on God and his relationship with mankind? Because he's attacking spiritually. You hear? He's attacking in a spiritual manner. He said, "Shall ye not eat of every tree of the garden?" He said, "Preacher, explain that to me." He said, "He took Eve's mind, not to all that God had given her to enjoy freely, but rather he wanted her to focus on the restrictions that God had and the limitations that he placed on her life." Man, does that sound familiar? How many of us look at what God hasn't gave us? Matter of fact, I'm going to be honest with you. That's the easiest thing for me to focus on. Because I can identify 10 things that God ain't gave me. But sometimes it's hard for me to recognize all of what God has blessed me with. So what he did was, he said, I'm going to attack you spiritually, and I'm going to go through your mind, and I'm going to change the way that you view the blessings of God. Wow. Man, if this ain't 2022, 23, if this ain't a Facebook message or what? I mean, isn't it real? He wants to focus all of the attention on what we can't have. So when Satan then he starts with questioning God's word, God's method, God's limitations, and when he starts questioning God's word, then he will cause a change to happen to God's word. So look at this. She spoke. She said, we may eat of the fruit of the tree of the garden, but the fruit of the tree which is in the midst of the garden, God had said, we shall not eat of it, neither shall we touch it, lest we die. So, preacher, how does she change God's word? Number one, if you're writing this down, she omitted the word freely. You notice? She minimizes the provisions of God that he has laid out when he said in verse 16, the Lord God commanded man, saying, of every tree of the garden thou may eat freely. She said, we can eat of the trees of the fruit of the garden. We can eat it. But he said, you can have it freely, any time you want. So this is when Satan recognizes, man, I think I got her. This was easier than I thought. I just shifted her focus beyond God's blessings back to what God is not letting her have, and she's now changing God's word. Okay, not only does she omit the word freely, but she also adds in the word touch it. Two words, touch it. Okay? You ready? Eve says, we can't eat of this tree. We can't even touch it. She turned God into a legalist, didn't she? She says, we can't even touch it. He didn't say anything about touching it. He could care less if you walked up to the tree, rubbed your face all up in the tree bark. He didn't care if you laid down and leaned up against the tree and enjoyed the shade while you took a nap. He didn't say anything about touching the tree, did he? He said, you just can't eat it. He didn't even say you couldn't pick the tree. You could pick all you want to. Just can't eat it. He said, you can't eat it. Right? That's pretty easy. But she said, I can't touch it either. I wonder, have y'all ever met that person? Y'all met her. I can't do that. Just can't. Can't do it. God just won't allow it. I am editing. See, this is me editing. When I'm laughing, I know that it's not going to be good. So let's move on. And not only does she omit a word, as she adds words, and then she uses a slight variant. She uses lest instead of surely. You hear that? What happens whenever you change the word? You weaken it. It's different meaning. It's kind of like when the ice melts inside your Coca-Cola, it just don't taste the same. It's a little weaker. It's weaker. She weakened what God was saying. She said, well, he said, we could die. We could die. No. We go back. He said, no, you're going to die. You eat it, you die. She's like, if I eat it and I touch it, I might die. So now she's, what's the word I'm looking for? It starts with a J. I know exactly what I'm just trying to get you where I'm going. What is she doing? She is justifying her actions. This is what happens when you manipulate what God says. You are justifying your own behaviors. You are turning what is completely wrong into something that could be okay to give yourself some sliver of hope of a place to stand on. I can look, I just can't touch. You ever heard that one? I can look all I want to. What does Jesus say about it? You're already committing adultery. I didn't read that. Read the Sermon on the Mount. It's right there. Okay? I spent a whole 16 years on it, okay? At least it felt like it. I was glad to be off the mount whenever I finished that one. I'm sure you were too. Because it hurt. Seeing the real truth of what Jesus really meant, it's tough. Well, here we are. We're looking for every avenue we can to justify our sins, because instead of just saying, hey, God, I'm sorry, we're looking for ways to justify our behavior. Now, look here, and I'm done. I'm done, all right? I'm just lying. I'm not done. I'm just lying. I'm not done. Just completely lied to y'all. I'm sorry. I'm nowhere near done. When my face is red as I feel. I ain't got no water. All right, so when Satan starts questioning God's word, or allows us to start questioning God's word, or pushes us to question God's word, then we change God's word. And then the last thing was, he comes in and contradicts God's word. So he begins to twist it even further. And look at verse number 4 and 5. It says, the serpent said to Eve, ye shall not surely die. So she already said, lest I die. She weakened it. Now he's just going to obliterate it. And then he's going to give false hope. Thank you. You're the man. So watch. Hear me well. All right? She weakened it, justified it. He come and manipulates it. How does he manipulate it? By telling her what she wants to hear. Oh, wait. You know how he knows why she wants to hear this? Because it's exactly what he was thinking whenever he fell. For God doth know that in the day that ye eat thereof, then ye shall be opened. Your eyes shall be opened, and ye shall be as gods, knowing good and evil. You're not going to die. In fact, you're going to be the opposite. You're going to be just like him. He said, "You." He hands the pill to her. She holds it in her hand and looks at it. She says, "I know that touching this, could kill me. It could." And then Satan speaks in her ear and says, "Honey, that pill's not going to kill you. It's going to turn you into Superwoman." I'm going to talk to my Christian friends. The ones that think Jesus is an alcoholic. Your justification of your behavior. Because you don't want to be labeled. And it's okay. It's a little bit for the belly. A little bit for the belly. It didn't ask a whole bottle for the belly. Amen. You know what I'm talking about? Yeah. Man, my belly's going to hurt later. I drank this whole thing. I need another one so my belly don't hurt. I'm going to make somebody mad, but I'm okay with it. Y'all going to be okay with me getting somebody mad. I'm fine with it too. You can look at it. Number one, let me say this. It didn't hurt you not to drink it. What makes you think you need to drink it? But it tastes good. Water tastes great to me. Sweet tea. Yeah, lemonade. Bang. Am I hitting anybody? Am I hitting everybody in here tonight? Coffee? Y'all could even have that yuppie coffee with all that stuff in it that turns it white. It's you. You like it. It's like this much coffee and the rest froth. But here we are. Christians will get it in their hands and they'll like, they're looking through the Bible for reasons why they can have something that they're watching other people get their lives destroyed by. Do you hear me? You're working twice as hard to get something that really is not that beneficial to your life anyway. Whether it's right or wrong, it's not good for you. It changes and alters who you are. Why would God want you to have something that changes who you are? When he said, "You are fearfully and wonderfully made." Wow. But here we go. We look at it. Man, this looks good. And he goes up to you and goes, "Yeah, it looks good, doesn't it?" "Oh, but God said I can't drink it." Oh, God didn't say, "Look, Jesus over there." He had a whole party. And matter of fact, they ran out. He said, "Let me make some more for them." That's what God did. But you drink just a little bit of that, and you won't die. It'll turn you into Superman. Is this hitting anybody here tonight? You see, we can justify ourselves into the most tragic situations. Let me talk about your preacher for a minute. Mr. Weight Loss himself. I could get on that MyFitnessPal and I could track my calories. And I lie. Sausage. There it is. 15 calories. It was sausage, right? So I have 7,000 calories left at the end. I can definitely have that piece of cake. I can justify myself and my behavior while I'm really hungry and I don't have time to get something that's a little bit more healthy. So I think it'd be all right. God'd be okay with it. If I go get a Mary B. extra bacon and hash brown. And then you get ready to drive off. And the lady's saying thank you. And you say, hold on. Can I get another hash brown? The Lord has convicted me. I cannot have. This is a two hash brown kind of days. Am I the only one who's like this, though? You see, sin is sin no matter how you label it. Gluttony is just as bad as drugs and alcohol. Gluttony is just as bad as pornography and adultery. Baptists don't like when you talk about gluttony, do they? They want to say, praise God, let's have a potluck next Sunday. We can have a potluck, we just can't have the whole pot. Amen. I'm almost done, and that ain't a lie. Verse number 6. I'm going to give you this last name thing because I've never seen or read it like this until today. And this is pretty much the only reason why I wanted to go all the way back and preach this again. He said, when the woman saw, look at the word saw. When the woman saw that the tree was good for food, that it was pleasant to the what? Eyes. And a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. Did you notice? It kind of struck me today when I was reading this, and I mean, she's been in that garden for a long time. She's looked at all the trees. She obviously had knowledge that this tree, the knowledge of good and evil, wasn't a tree for her to eat. So therefore, she's already seen it, right? And the Bible says now she's seen it. So it struck me today. This was not her first time seeing it. This was her first time seeing it through the lens that Satan had created in her eyes. He had completely manipulated her into seeing what God explicitly said no to as being good. All of the process brings it to this. She's seen it the way that Satan framed it for her to see. Sydney sent me a text message this week, Brother Pass, and it kind of got me. Because sometimes I have been guilty in the past of scrolling through Facebook and getting jealous of other people's whatever, name it. Mostly boats and four-wheelers. It's mostly it. I ain't really got any other jealousy than that. And but she sent me this picture, and it was a mirror. I should have sent it to you, Jason, so everybody can see it. It's a mirror and an apple, and you see the reflection of the apple. And you, in the app, you see that perfect, beautiful apple. But it also lets you see the back of the apple at the same time. And the back of the apple had this big, huge bite out of it. Because the view that they wanted you to see in the mirror was perfection. But on the backside, things were missing. This is how Satan designs his work in our lives. He only shows you what he knows you want to see. And all you have to do is be obedient. That's it. All you have to do is what God says yes to, you say yes to. But then he comes in and sits down beside you, and you never had doubt on a subject before. And he starts whispering in your ears. Nobody will ever listen to you preach. They know who you used to be. Nobody will ever sit in your Sunday school class, because the lifestyle that you used to have, nobody. Nobody will ever let their children spend time with your children because of who you are. God never wants you to be a parent. Because you messed up 50 years ago and you had your shot. Am I the only one who he's ever lied to? Had your heart taken out of your chest and stomped on because he knew exactly what you wanted. And he manipulated it to make you think that God didn't have it for you. And all the while, God says you can have anything you want. You can have this, and 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 you can have this. Stop focusing on that one thing. When you have all of this that I gave you, don't let Satan frame your life. Let God. Because you're created in his image, not Satan's. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Look at that picture up there. Wow. Technology, you guys. Y'all enjoy that on your way out here in a minute. Every head bowed and every eye closed. Nobody looking around. We've seen the simplicity of just being obedient to God. We see that the method of Satan and how he attacks everything, and he even gets us caught up in the attack, and he uses what we think, how we act, how we frame things, and he manipulates it into this picture so that he can keep us from saying yes to what God wants us to do. May I say to you that this is a spiritual problem. Jesus, you and I need to align ourselves in a spiritual manner if we are to win this battle. We have to go before the Almighty God. Say, God, I didn't know it was like this. But I'm not blaming Eve for my problems, and I'm not blaming the serpent. It is me who made this choice. Will you take your lamb and cover? Oh, what a wonderful truth. With every head bowed, every eye closed, nobody looking around, I want to ask you tonight, if you're here today and you've accepted Jesus Christ as your Savior, would you lift your hand in testimony and just say, I have, I have. Praise God. Maybe you're here tonight and you say, Preacher, I don't know if I've ever been saved, but I'd like to know. He's my hand. Maybe you're here tonight and you say this, Preacher, will you pray for me that I'd be obedient even when the devil starts twisting things up? Here's my hand. Praise God. Maybe you'll say this, Preacher, will you pray for me? I've been telling God no, trying to justify why I'm telling him no. Will you pray for me? And me and him will get things right. Here's my hand. Yeah, amen. Amen. We already got one coming to the altar. I wonder how many people would step out of their seat and make some things right with God today. Say, I want to be obedient. These are all people coming all over the place right now.
Sometimes I'm scared.
Praise God.
Take it in. Is that you?
Lord, we thank you for this day. We thank you for being so good to us. Lord, the growth that I feel in this room tonight as we pull back the curtains of things that we have experienced ourselves and just didn't fully understand. God, we're sorry. Help us not to listen to Satan whenever he puts limitations on your power and your provisions. Help us to see, while we're focusing in on the one thing that we can't have, we should be thankful for all the things that you have given us. While he's trying to limit who we are and the voice that you gave us to the lives of the people that you put around us, help us to recognize that we just need to stop thinking about everything he's saying. Start glorifying what you're saying. And that's that people need to hear more about you. We love you, Lord, in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Pray for tomorrow night. It'll be true freedom. And there'll be, I think this is the new turnover. So there's going to be about 30 to 40 lost people in the room tomorrow night. And Christians, you better pray. I'm looking for big fruit to fall tomorrow night. There's no more tomorrow, only today. And pray that if you want to work in that ministry, see, Brother Mike, it'd be a great fruitful ministry. We need people to make coffee. We need people to watch kids. We need people to shake hands, put up tables, take down tables. We need this is part of the ministry. I don't know if anybody's ever told you that, but this stuff's ministry. The carpets don't clean themselves. Thankfully, we have somebody who feels that's their ministry. And this part, light bulbs don't change themselves. Praise God. The lights doesn't keep themselves on. There's people out there who's keeping the light. Your Motel 6 in us, amen. Keeping the lights on. And we're thankful for that. We all are a part of God's ministry. We just need to take response. Don't let Satan say, no, you ain't doing nothing. Well, some people, he ain't doing nothing. But some people, amen, everybody is doing something. Praise God. I joke, and I'm glad people are finally getting it. I'm thankful to be here tonight. Hope you enjoyed church. Sunday morning, pray. This will be my last prayer request for Sunday. Pray for Sunday morning. I'm going to start a new sermon series called This. It's a Love Story, Baby, Just Say Yes. Okay? All right? It's going to be weird and awkward. But most love stories are, right? All right, Brother Pastor, will you pray for us?